in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be free from your passion and pride? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Come for a cleansing to Calvary's side. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is
coming out. We're glad to have you here today. If you are a guest, thank you for being here. There's a card in the back of the seat in front of you. If you could fill that out, you can put it in the collection plate when it passes a little bit later in our service. And we'd like to just send a note and say thanks for visiting with us. If you have a prayer request, indicate that on the prayer on that card, and we'll be praying about that throughout the week. Just really, really glad you're here. And if you're looking for a church home, love to talk to you about how we receive new members. In fact, yesterday, guys, do we have that slide? Yesterday, this is Wanda Thompson, and she was baptized yesterday here. We had several folks that were with her here. Joe and Kathy Thomas were here, Sarah McMurtry, her mom, her dad, and several of her family members. And so, Wanda, can you stand up so folks can see where you are? Let's give her a hand. Welcome. Glad to have Wanda. You will notice as we sing this morning, you'll see the theme of service will keep coming up, like that oldie that we just sang a second ago. Would you do service for Jesus your King? Watch for that theme as we go along this morning. But now, here's another thing I want you to think about. And this occurred to me last night. I was thinking about, kind of praying about today, and it occurred to me that this particular group of people, this group, will probably never be together again at the same time in the same place. Because next week, some of us will be gone and others will be back. And so this particular group, we will probably never be together again as we are exactly right now, which kind of makes what we're about to do really important. I mean, hugely important. We're about to praise God, this particular group of people. So let's stand up. I want you to hear a passage from God's Word. Let's go ahead and stand. This is from Psalm 91, and this is going to be our call to worship this morning. This group of people, the last time this particular group will, the only time this particular group will ever be together. It's kind of a powerful thought. Hear the word of the Lord. Whoever dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and fortress, my God in whom I trust. Surely He will save you from the fowler's snare and from the deadly pestilence. He will cover you with His wings, and under His wings you will find refuge. His faithfulness, the faithfulness of the mighty God, His faithfulness will be your shield and your rampart. Let's praise the Lord together.
Everyone needs compassion, a love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty.
Apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors and teachers, to equip his people for works of service, so that the body of Christ may be built up until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ.
Then we will no longer be infants, tossed back and forth by the waves and blown here and there by every wind of teaching and by the cunning and craftiness of people in their deceitful scheming. Instead, speaking the truth in love, we will grow to become in every respect the mature body of Him who is the head, that is Christ. From Him, the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work.
Certainly every work and every word, of praise that we sing or speak honors and glorifies God, but nothing praises Him like our works of service. Think about that as we share this new prayer this morning, Unbroken Praise.
Praise unbroken, praise unending, be yours, be yours.
Continue our prayer with these words, that our lives and our deeds and our actions and our service might be all about others and bring glory to your name. Give us the hearts of a servant. We thank you for who you are, the Almighty, the Omnipotent, the Omniscient, the King. And because you are the King, we serve you. Bless us now as we continue our worship. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's take our offering.
I am thine, O Lord, I have heard thy voice, and extolled thy love to me. But I long to rise in the arms of faith.
we take the communion, one of the best descriptions of the attitude we should have is found in Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 11. Reading from the New American Standard Version. Have this attitude in yourselves, which was also in Christ Jesus, who, although he existed in the form of God, did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself, taking the form of a bondservant, and being made in the likeness of men, being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. For this reason also, God highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name, so that the name of Jesus every knee will bow, of those who are in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and that every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Paul says, make your own attitude that of Christ Jesus. So what did Jesus do? He did not consider equality with God as something to be used for his own advantage. He emptied himself by assuming the form of a slave. He humbled himself. He became obedient to the point of death, even to death on a cross. Would you bow with me? Father God, as we take this bread, we ask you to give us the mind of Christ. Give us that mind throughout every waking moment. Father, thank you for this bread. Bless it to our bodies. We ask this in Jesus. Amen.
Make me a servant, Lord, make me like you. For you are a servant, make me one too. Lord, make me a servant, do what you have
Time Rainier, in this book that we've been reading, he talks about Philippians chapter 2. He says, keep in mind that Philippians 2 is not only a description of the obedience of Christ, it is an example for us to follow. We are to be servants. We are to be obedient. We are to put others first. We are to do whatever it takes to keep the unity in our church. And he relates a story about a guy that was a mentor, a guy named Bob. He told me that we were, and this is a guy that he was mentoring, says he told me that we were to find joy in serving the church and those in the church. We were not a part of the church to see what we could get out of it. We were a part of the church to serve and care for others. Our perspective should always be on giving, not receiving. And if someone did something that disappointed or frustrated us, that was God's way of telling us to pray for that person. Bob told me that we could never have the perfection of Christ, but that we could strive to be more like him. He reminded me that Christ died on the cross for people who rebelled against him. We should be able, therefore, to love the seemingly unlovable at our church. Would you bow with me? Father God, help us to love Twickenham as Christ loves it. Forgive me when I don't have the attitude of Christ. Father, be with us now as we take this cup. Bless it to us. We ask this in Jesus. Amen.
More holiness give me,
more strivings within, more patience in suffering, more sorrow for sin, more faith
The teaching council here at Twickenham is looking for ways to better serve our church in a more informed kind of way. Specifically, we're trying to make sure that the things that we share teaching in our classrooms and in this venue are really meeting our needs. And so we've found a survey that we think will help us better identify where our growing edges are as a church. That's called the Transformational Discipleship Assessment. And you should have received an email, if you're a member here, you should have received an email about that. It's an 82-question survey. So it'll take you a few minutes to do it, 15 to 20 minutes, depending on. We had one member complain about how long it took, so we kicked them out. you know, we play hardball. I mean, it's just... We really didn't. That one of the reasons I'm telling you it's going to take a while is because he said, it takes a while. So take about 15, 20 minutes. You can start it and come back to it later. You don't have to do it all in one sitting. It would be better to do it all in one sitting, but you don't have to do it that way. So you can do it here and there. But we would really, really love for you to do that. And this is just, we're always looking for ways for you to give us input so that we can hear what's going on. And this is a good way for you to give us some input about where you feel your spiritual needs are. So if you did not get an email, give us a call at the church office. We'll be sure you get one. But it's called the Transformational Discipleship Assessment. And we think it's a pretty powerful tool and can be for us. Okay. So we'll go ahead and look in your Bibles in Romans chapter 16. That's the first place that I think it's the first place that we'll go today. I may have that wrong. But we'll find out. Romans 16 is one of the big stops, though. Last weekend, in near Corpus Christi, Texas, 34-year-old Tracy Anderwall, that's her sitting up there, the mom, and her 5-year-old daughter, Allison, were enjoying some mother-daughter time in Tracy's sister's backyard pool. Tracy, the mom, suddenly had a seizure while she was in the pool and blacked out and sank to the bottom. Allison, that's the 5-year-old wrapped in the towel there, Allison realized that her mother hadn't surfaced for air. And so the 5-year-old girl dived into the pool, swam to the bottom of the deep end, and dragged her mother to the shallow end. And she couldn't get her out of the pool, so she turned her over so that her face would be above water. And then Allison jumped out of the pool and found her aunt, who called 911. A few days later, this is the scene, Tracy woke up to learn that her daughter is apparently gifted to protect and rescue. Last Wednesday in Kansas, this is 8-year-old Abby Porter. She was riding in the front seat next to her mom on the way to school. Routine drive to school. They do it every morning until Abby's mom slumped forward unconscious into the steering wheel. And Abby unbuckled her seatbelt, climbed up onto the console, and began steering the car through traffic. And she couldn't reach the brake pedals, so she just kept steering. And a police officer finally noticed that this car was weaving out of traffic, so he pulled up alongside. He realized what was going on because the mom slumped over and the little girl's got that, you know, somebody help me look going on. And so he motioned for Abby to roll the window down. She did, and he shouted that he was going to pull in front of her and use his brakes to stop her and that she should just go ahead and let her car hit his. So he did, stopped the car. Emergency medical services were called, and Mrs. Porter was treated for a diabetic reaction and then released from the hospital. Police took Abby home to her relieved father, and everybody was praising her for being a great heroine. But she didn't let it go to her head. She told her dad, I got to get back to summer school. I have a spelling test. So she was really intent. I don't know if Allison is the swimmer. I don't know if she's going to be a Navy SEAL or a lifeguard or some other protector, or if Abby is going to be the next Danica Patrick. But there is clearly something special about both those little girls. Now, I don't think it's going to make the papers, but there is no telling how many hidden gifts and how much hidden talent is sitting right here in this room. For the last several weeks, we've been talking about what it means to be gifted, about being graced to work in the kingdom of God, graced to use the gifts God has given us to work. We are, every one of us, graced by God to work for His purposes and to bless others. And just to remind you, we do not work or serve in order to get a reaction out of God. Okay, we're not trying to earn credits with God when we work, when we serve, when we let our deeds outrun our words. We're not trying to get a reaction out of God. We're responding to what God has already done for us in Jesus Christ. So here's what we've learned so far. We've learned that every Christian has some spiritual gift, an ability, an aptitude, or a skill given by God to you, to me, for the good of others. We've learned that there are many different kinds of gifts, and that diversity is a good thing. That means that you have some skills, some gifts, some aptitudes, some abilities that I don't have. And if you weren't here and using that gift, that skill, that aptitude, that ability, this church and this community would be much the less for it. The diversity is a good thing. We've learned that all gifts come from God. We can't take credit for them. We can't use those, well, we can, but we're not supposed to use those gifts for our own glory. We're supposed to use them for others to God's glory. We sang about that this morning as well. And then we learned that there are no unimportant, unnecessary gifts. The value of the gift, the ability, the aptitude, the talent, whatever it is you want to call it, is not bound up in you. It's bound up in who gave it. Because God gave that gift, it is a valuable gift. So this morning, we're going to talk about how to discover the gift or the gifts God has given us. And that's important for a lot of different reasons. For one, Paul said that God has arranged the parts of the body just as He wants them to be. That's in 1 Corinthians 12:18. That means that not only is each of us gifted to work, but each of us has some work to do in the kingdom of God. Knowing what your gift is, knowing how God has gifted you, can help you discern, figure out what God wants you to be doing. And then knowing where and how God wants you working in His kingdom will help you connect with other people, which is a thing we all want, right? I mean, you do want to have rich and deep and meaningful connections with other people. Isn't that one of the reasons we come here on Sundays? To begin to create rich and deep and meaningful connections? Isn't that one of the reasons some of you come on Wednesday nights? Some? Amen. You know we meet on Wednesday nights. You guys know that? I know some of you didn't know that. Otherwise, of course you'd be here. So we want those relationships. So how does that happen? How do we create close and significant relationships? Our go-to strategy is to orchestrate fun. I mean, let's do something fun together. We'll make a memory together. We'll become closer together. And you know, the truth is, we to some extent, that's accurate. We will make a memory if we do something fun together, and we will look back and we'll laugh about that, and that'll draw us a little bit closer. But I want to show you another way. I blogged about that this morning on my blog, jodyvickery.com. Look in Romans chapter 16, the last chapter of Paul's magnum opus on grace. He mentions over 35 different people in these verses, and they weren't his golfing buddies, and they weren't his bunco buddies. They didn't go on weekend retreats together. They were his fellow workers. He calls them that three times in Romans 16. Several times he says, they worked hard side by side with me. And then a bunch of times he'll say, they worked very hard with me. Some of them were imprisoned for preaching Jesus. They were imprisoned with Paul for preaching Jesus. Some of them risked their lives for him. They were people, Paul said, who had been a great help to many other people. Paul enjoyed deep relationships with all of these people because he had served together. And I'm going to tell you something I think about Paul. I think Paul was probably hard to like. I mean, it'll sound a little weird coming from a preacher, but I think he was just so intense, so gung-ho, that you had to kind of gear up emotionally when you were going to spend time with him, and you needed time to recover after you'd been with him. And I think he really struggled not to be irritated with people who weren't as gung-ho as he was. And yet he had all these friends. He had all these relationships. And this was before Facebook and Instagram and Snapchat and the U.S. mail. He just made all of these friends, and he did it through service. He did it because his gifts and their gifts were put together and they worked together. You people with a military background understand this, right? You know this to be true. You serve with somebody, you create a bond that just can't be broken. Perhaps more than any other reason, that's why you need to know what your gifts are. When you know how you're gifted, you know where to serve. And when you know where to serve, you don't just bless people, you bond with people. I'm telling you, coming in here is awesome. We need to do this together. This is important. But if you really want to bond with people, you need to serve with them. And when you serve with them, that's when you really connect. So how do you discover what your gift is? Good news is, there's no one right way. There are lots of different ways for you to discover your gift. Here's the thing you can do. Go online, Google or Bing, gift assessment. Just gift assessment, spiritual gift assessment. There are all kind of instruments out there that you can go online. They're absolutely free, and they're a lot shorter than the 82 questionnaire that we really want you to take, okay? But that can help you. I've done those, and they're generally pretty accurate. There are a lot of articles out there you can read online, just a ton of articles that you can read online. Some of them are pretty good, some of them are not, because those people obviously didn't have the gift of writing articles about spiritual gifts. But the most thoughtful approach I found is in a book by a guy named Peter Wagner. The book is called Your Gifts Can Help Your Church Grow. It's a little bit old, but I still haven't found anything better than this, than just kind of what he lays out here. First, he says, you need to start by exploring the possibilities. Just explore the possibilities. The best place to begin is with the Bible. We did that a little bit last week. You'll remember this slide. There are several gifts and roles that are mentioned in Romans chapter 12, 1 Corinthians chapter 12, Ephesians chapter 4, 1 Peter chapter 4. You kind of see what some of those are. Just exploring the possibilities. There's prophecy, serving, teaching, encouragement, etc. You can just see that's a great place to begin by reading those passages and exploring the scripture to see what the possibilities are out there. But don't just limit your exploration of the possibilities to gifts that are mentioned in the New Testament. Let me share a passage with you. Listen to this from Exodus chapter 31. Wait, there's gifts in the Old Testament? Listen to this. Then the Lord said to Moses, Exodus 31, beginning in verse 1, the Lord said to Moses, see, I have chosen Bezalel, son of Uri, the son of Hur, of the tribe of Judah, and I have filled him with the Spirit of God, with wisdom, with understanding, with knowledge, and with all kinds of skills, to make artistic designs for work in gold, silver, and bronze, to cut and set stones, to work in wood, to engage in all kinds of crafts. Moreover, I have appointed Oholiab, son of Ahishmach, I'm so glad we don't name our children things like that these days, of the tribe of Dan to help him. Also, I have given ability to all the skilled workers to make everything I have commanded you. God considers the ability to work with your hands a spiritual gift. Remember what he said? I have filled this guy with the Spirit of God, and that enabled him to work with his hands. We have a ministry here called PAR, P-A-R, Prepare and Respond. They go out after a tornado or a flood, and these guys use heavy equipment and chainsaws to help people who are affected by the disaster to recover. I want to read you an email that we got last week from Dave Morrell, who heads up this ministry. Just listen to this email. Special thanks goes out to Mike and Jacob Pryor for their welding skills for modifying the Bobcat grapple to better protect the hydraulic hoses and connectors. I got nothing right there. They also do a great job servicing our chainsaws to be prepared for the next deployment. Thanks also goes to Doug Herring for maintaining the trailer and replacing all the supplies, safety equipment, and tools that are lost or broken during deployments. Of course, Doug's job would be a lot easier if he would stop breaking things. I think maybe I wasn't supposed to read that last part. So, mate, you see what I'm talking about here, right? These guys are not teaching a class or preaching a sermon or leading a song, but they're using their spiritual gifts to bless people. Did you know that we have a mower ministry? This group of guys goes around mowing the lawns and trimming hedges of older folks who can't do it themselves. Tracy Pollard heads up that ministry. Sounds to me like these guys have the gift of helping. So step one to figure out what your gift is just explore the possibilities. There are a lot of them out there. Step two is to experiment with as many possibilities as you can. If you don't know what your gift is, one of the best ways is just try something. And I want to go ahead and deal with the demon right here, okay? Because you know why most people don't experiment with different ministry and service possibilities? You know why we don't do that? Because we're afraid to fail. We're afraid to fail. And this is why heady stuff like theology is so important. Okay, Romans chapter 5, Paul says that while we were still sinners, spiritual failures, Christ died for us. It goes on to say that if a bunch of low-down, good-for-nothing, chicken-stealing sinners can be saved by the death of Jesus, how much more can we be saved through His resurrection? If we were saved when we were steeped in sin by His death, how much more now that we are His children will we be saved? We're saved by grace, and folks, we serve by grace. Look, nobody's good at everything. I'll tell you two things I'm not good at, okay? I really want to take the sting out of failure, take the fear out of failure, so I'm going to tell you two things I'm awful at. I would be useless to the guys in the disaster recovery or the mower ministry. Useless. My wife cuts our grass. I can't even successfully string my weed eater. I either wind it so tight that the string won't advance, or so loosely that as soon as I rev it up, it just goes flying off into space. When I run out of string, I just go buy a new weed eater. I walk into Lowe's and they go, "Hi, Mr. Vickery, we got your weed eater here." I'll tell you another thing I'm not good at. I'm a lousy counselor. I'm terrible. People who are gifted to counsel are really good listeners, and they are deeply empathetic. If you need somebody to talk, I'm your guy. But if you got a problem, I don't want to hear it. Okay? Go to Lincoln. He cares. I'm just trying to help. No. I'm kidding, mostly. All right? The ability to listen with spiritual discernment and diagnose a problem is not one of my primary gifts. I can do it, but it doesn't flow out of me the way my primary gifts do. My point is this: you are not going to be good at everything you experiment with, and that's okay. But you aren't going to find your gift if you don't try some new things. So explore the possibilities, experiment, and don't worry, just try it. And then Wagner says to examine your feelings. Explore, experiment, examine. What do you care about? What are the things that burden your heart? What stirs your blood? What makes you pound a desk? What are you willing to go to the wall for? If something fires you up and makes you passionate, that's probably a pretty good indicator that it's hitting somewhere near your gifts. Let me show you another biblical example of that. 2 Corinthians chapter 11, beginning in verse 25. Paul is not talking about spiritual gifts here. He's actually reciting his resume to silence his critics. But what he says reveals a lot about his passions. And his passions reveal something about where his gifts are placed. Listen to what he says. This is 2 Corinthians 11, beginning of verse 25. Five times I received from the Jews 40 lashes minus one, 39 stripes. Three times I was beaten with rods. Once I was pelted with stones. Three times I was shipwrecked. I spent a night and a day in the open sea. I've been constantly on the move. I have been in danger from rivers, in danger from bandits, in danger from my fellow Jews, in danger from Gentiles, in danger in the city, in danger in the country, in danger at sea, in danger from false believers. I have labored and toiled and have gone, often gone without sleep. I have known hunger and thirst and often gone without food. I have been cold and naked. Besides everything else, I face the daily pressure of my concern for all the churches. Do you think it's accurate to say that Paul was willing to endure persecution and hunger and danger in order to reach the lost and mature the saved? He endured severe cold, storms at sea, tireless work. His willingness to endure all that hardship was strong confirmation that his gifts included evangelism, preaching, and leadership. You don't go through all that stuff unless you're deeply passionate about it, about what you're doing, and your passions are going to match up with your gifts. So examine your feelings. If something is tugging at your heart, if something right now feels like a burden, that may be the Spirit's way of pulling you toward your gift. God gave us the ability to feel as well as the ability to do something about the things we feel strongly about. So take a look at how you're feeling. Where are your feelings pointing you? Explore, experiment, examine. One more, expect confirmation from the body. We don't discover, develop, and use our spiritual gifts in isolation. The abilities, the talents, the aptitudes God gives us are given for the good of the body, for the good of the community, for the good of the church. If you use what you believe is a gift, and others in the body recognize and affirm that, you are probably on the right track. I remember to this day, and I was about 10 years old, I remember to this day what an elder of the church said to me after I preached my first sermon. It was a word of encouragement to me. I've never forgotten what he said. And so when people affirm you, that lets you know maybe I'm headed in the right direction here. The flip side of that, though, is that sometimes we feel like man, I got this gift. I know I got this gift, but nobody else seems to agree with us that we have that gift. Okay, this is the hard part. And it calls for great humility. If you think you're gifted in a particular area, but the body is not confirming that for you, the church is not confirming that for you, you need to humbly take a closer look and reevaluate. The flip side of that is that if somebody is serving in a way that blesses you, you need to tell them. You need to affirm that. Not to give them the credit, but to confirm that what they're doing is glorifying God by blessing you. So there needs to be a lot of affirmation going on in our church. If somebody is blessing you, you need to say that. You need to say, man, that blessed me. I praise God for the gift he gave you because it's blessing me. Okay, explore the variety of gifts that we read about in the Bible and include the gifts that you see others around you using. Just explore the possibilities. Experiment with as many different gifts as you can. Try things out. Get involved in various ministries. See what fits. And please don't be afraid to fail, because you're going to. Just don't be afraid of that. Examine your own feelings. What excites you? What motivates you? What makes you want to sacrifice time and money and effort? Expect confirmation from those whom you serve. More than 30 times, the New Testament refers to the community of Christians as the body of Christ. You and I are like cells in that body. Each one of us has a really important function. When we discover what God has designed us to do, at least two things happen. We get this endorphin-like feeling of fulfillment. This is what I was created to accomplish. The body is blessed with the kind of relational health God intended. And then another thing is we form deep relationships because we're serving with and for each other to the glory of God. You were put on this planet for more than just making yourself happy and acquiring stuff and having fun. God put you on this planet for a purpose, and he gifted you to accomplish that purpose. And I'm calling you today, please don't be afraid to try. Nobody here is going to laugh at you. Nobody here is going to make fun of you. We're going to support you all the way. Don't be afraid. You're saved by grace. You serve by grace. Fear is what the devil is trying to whisper in your ear to keep you from discovering the gift God gave you and using it to the service of this body and this community and for God's glory. And don't you listen to him. He's a liar. Don't be afraid. Let's stand. Let's sing. Let's have a great week for the Lord.
We are not afraid to follow where you lead, leaving what we know.
We are not afraid. We will be.
directory pictures start this week. And we only do a directory once every 2 years. So you want to get in now or else we won't know your face for 2 whole years, okay? So make sure you can sign up in the lobby right outside as soon as we're done, or you can call the church office. Please do that. Last dinner and a Devo of the season this Wednesday night. And Todd White will be speaking. We'll have baked potatoes with all of the stuffings and ingredients and leftovers from the prior meals of the summer to put on those potatoes, reuse some of that stuff. So be here Wednesday for that. Thirdly, I do not want to hear your problems. I don't know where that came from. Completely, I'm just kidding. We'd love to hear your problems anytime. Hey, thanks for being here. We hope you have an outstanding week, and we'll close in prayer.
Bow with me. Father, you are so, so good to us. Lord, you are slow to anger, but abounding in love. And God, we thank you for that. We thank you that you made it a way to be possible to come to you, your Son, Jesus, that we have the ability to be saved through him. God, on the cross, Jesus hung there, and he took an amount of just astonishing pain, anguish for our sins. That's his gift to us. But more importantly, Father, we thank you that he rose again, victorious, steadfast, conquering, with never-ending love for us. And he defied the devil himself to do it. Father, I pray that all of us that are here today, that we'll be good stewards of the gifts that you've blessed us with, discovered or yet to be discovered. Father, thank you for this lesson. Thank you for the church. And thank you for all the hands and the minds and the souls and the spirits that come together each and every day to make this possible. But more importantly, Father, we thank you. Let us be bright lights and a vision of hope for all that come in contact with us as we leave here today and the days to follow. And it's in your holy name we pray. Amen.